All right, good morning. Happy Friday, happy end of week 10 and all that other good sort of stuff. So yeah, that's pretty much it. So I posted just kind of a synopsis of like what we've been talking about all quarter, and we can go through that. But you know, let's start. If you have any particular questions, anything you want to go over in particular, let's do that first because this list is not terribly exciting. I'm not lecturing on anything new today, so this is really just kind of a review, and unless you have questions, I'll just kind of start from the beginning of this list and go through and make some comments. I also do want to talk about the logistics of the exam before we go through topics. Yeah, I'm taking summer quarter too. I got to teach one class, but that's not too bad. Teaching 270, which I actually really like teaching in the summer because it's like 4 hours, you know, 2 hours lecture, 2 hours lab, done. Come back, do it once more in the week, done. It's kind of, it's nice to packetize it like that. And summer goes so quickly. And it's only 8 weeks for a quarter at Clark, so it'll pass fast. All right, well, so your final exam is Monday, 10 o'clock to 11:50. This will open up at 10 o'clock on Monday morning. Hey, you're very welcome. I was going to make some comments at the end, but yeah, I think it's been a really good year. I've definitely enjoyed working with everyone here, even though it's been online, even though, you know, some of you I have never actually met, actually most of you, but I think it's worked out well. And some of you, you know, I've had in classes for 2 years now, going back to 101 in some cases, and so that's pretty cool to kind of watch your progress through that. Speed grader is, you know, the fundamental axiom of capitalism, right? If something's called speed grader, it's probably not a speedy way to grade. Well, that's the case here. It's actually pretty slow. I remember talking to you about majors. Yeah, that was cool. So anytime you see something with a TM, basically means not what it sounds like, but it works. Cool. So final exam will be an assignment. You look at it, it'll have several questions on it. Write up the answers to those questions, save it as a PDF, submit it. You do not get the grade as soon as you turn it in. Your grade as soon as you turn it in, well, no, it won't show up. I used to do this as quizzes, and then people would turn in their exam, and they'd have a zero. But grading quizzes in Canvas is a little tricky, so... says we are submitting nothing. Yeah, I haven't set it up yet. But eventually it will, this will lock, right, until 10 o'clock, and then it'll have an upload area. So yeah, logistics, right? Plan on being in Zoom during the exam. You know, there's always things that I do on the exam that make no sense, or I forget to mention something, or I change a variable name one place and not another, and stuff like that. So I'll keep my microphone muted during the exam, but if, you know, somebody pings me and says, hey, you know, question 6, you asked to do such and such, what does that mean? right, I'll open my microphone and just kind of make an announcement and say, hey, there's a typo in this question and so on. So plan on being in Zoom in the regular classroom, right, this room we're in now, and just kind of leaving it in the background. And I'll try to leave my mic muted so it's not disturbing. But that lets me pass on information about, you know, changes or clarifications or things like that. What if we ask if you can give us the answers? I mean, you can always ask. But, you know, to some degree, sometimes people will say, you know, I'm not sure about such and such. You know, what does that mean? And if that's not the thing I'm trying to assess on, I'll say, you know, oh, yeah, that's, you know, I'll go ahead and tell people what it is. But if that's the thing that I'm asking for, then it's like, well, you know, try to figure that out. So you can actually ask for the answers, and sometimes get them. All right, other logistics. So open book, open note, right? You can use the textbook, you can use your notes, you can use your old assignments. You can use the stuff you've turned in on Git. Have all that stuff readily available. You cannot use online sources. Okay, so same as the midterm, no Chegg, Course Hero, Wikipedia, Google, Stack Overflow, etc. Pretty obvious. Do not use Eclipse. Do not use a you know, syntax checking, code completion editor, development environment IDE, nothing like that, right? Plain text editor. If it's syntax highlights, that's okay. You can use Java docs, right? So if you haven't downloaded all the Java documentation locally, you can use that online set of manual pages for the Java doc, right? But that's very specific. So I think docs.oracle.com or something like that. Right. So you know, everybody's on their honor here, right? We're not using lockdown browsers and things like that. And if you're not sure whether you can use something, the answer is probably no, but you can always ask, right? But I think most of you probably have a pretty good understanding of the intent here. Right, so you want to be doing your own work, turning in your own code, and so on and so forth. Any kind of weird window builder code we have to know. So when we use window builder, it creates a bunch of code for us. Like if we, you know, click on a button and say add an event handler, it creates a bunch of code that sets up, you know, an event listener, right? So, and then typically we go in and we add some extra code in there. So I might give you know, snippets of code that show, you know, some of those templates that are created by Window Builder and ask you to put in, you know, your customized code into there to do something. So basically the stuff that you've been doing with Window Builder to write PA4, to write PA5, you should be prepared to do that on the exam on paper though. But I'm not going to ask you know, from scratch to create the code for an event handler or, you know, a mouse listener, creating a J frame and all that kind of stuff. But you might see the stuff that you've, you know, been seeing when you use Window Builder and Swing. Let's see what else. I think that's it for weird logistics. Again, and we did this on the midterm, we've done this in other classes, but you know, figure out a way to type up text and turn it into a PDF that doesn't require you to, you know, while the clock is ticking, figure out how to get your indenting correct, or figure out how to not capitalize the first letter of every statement, right? And that kind of stuff. So just figure out a way to do that. Notepad, VI, Emacs, you know, something better than Word or Google Docs. Or, you know, if you're really good with Word or Google Docs, you know how to get it to behave and not mess with your indenting and capitalization and so on and so forth. That works too. Can we have the code open in Eclipse during the exam? If you do that just for looking at the code, that's okay, but I don't want you typing into Eclipse, right? I don't want you typing in, the word try curly bracket and having it, complete a try catch block for you, right? I want that in your notes or in your head. So I would say rather than going into Eclipse, just take your code from Eclipse and just work in the source directory. So if you have a workspace, then under your workspace there's a directory with your project name, and under that directory there's a file called src. That's where all your source code should be. And so you can go in that directory and look at your files in there. So yeah, stay away from Eclipse. Let's see, anything else on logistics? I think that's pretty much it. Basic setup will be mostly programming questions. I may throw in some short answer or multiple choice, but possibly not. Those don't seem to help students, even though multiple choice is what we always look for in exams. Students seem to do worse on those, because, I don't know, there's less wiggle room. It's like right or wrong, you know. So it'll probably be primarily programming questions. And as always, right, some will be write a complete program to do this, some will be write a method or write a class or write a few lines of code to do this. So make sure you know what it's asking for before you start, coding up a new operating system or something. Short answers are lit. Short answers are better than multiple choice, I agree. Because I can kind of get a sense of what somebody's saying. So maybe some short answers. All right, oh yeah, except on physics. And as with the midterm, the assignment will not close automatically on Canvas, okay? It's due at 11:50. You got to submit it by the due time, okay? If you have an extended time allocation, you get extended time. But Canvas won't automatically lock out. It won't give you a countdown. It won't give you a reminder when it's due. I'll try to make an announcement in Zoom a few minutes before it's due and say, go ahead and upload what you have. But definitely get it turned in by the deadline, right? So I'm going to stick with my 10 points per minute if it's turned in late. Not as an extension of the allotted time, but as a motivation to say, turn it in on time. But if you get it in 30 seconds late, you get, a 90 instead of a zero. So that's pretty much the idea. Multiple choice physics. I wonder what that would be like. All right. Well, let's just kind of go through this. Yeah. All right. So possible final exam topics. This is not, you're not going to see questions on every one of these things, but I think this is a pretty comprehensive list. So the earlier stuff in here is similar to what you saw on the midterm. So writing code, analyzing code, answering questions about code. Here's some code, make a change to it, add some stuff to it, fix something, or write some code to do something. Yay, the Fizzard. I miss seeing Gothard around. All right, notion of object-oriented languages, right? We've been working with objects for the whole quarter, so the idea of basically I can see a structure plus code, right? So taking code and data and bundling it together on a single entity that we can pass around, so a variable in C but an object in Java. Java is interpreted, which means it compiles down to bytecode, and then that bytecode is interpreted by a virtual machine, as opposed to compiling down to, you know, machine code that's actually executed on a physical machine like the CPU. And so Java is pretty portable because all you need is a copy of the JVM and it can run the bytecode. Object-oriented methodologies and approaches to managing code and data. So bundling code and data. And why do we want to do this? One, it makes logical sense sometimes. If you have a particular type of data, there's certain ways you want to manipulate that or analyze that. There's certain functions or methods that go along with that data. Put those together, right? We don't compute the area of a linked list. We don't ask for the number of elements in a rectangle, right? So why would we have, you know, a linked list and a rectangle and then an area method and a number of elements method, totally just kind of like sitting around in space unrelated to one another? So take the linked list and the number of elements method, put those together, right? Take the rectangle and the area method, put those together. So it's logically connecting the code with the data that the code works on. So encapsulation, right, putting all that stuff together, goes along with information hiding, right? So expose the parts of your object, right, that you want the user to interact with, and hide the parts that you don't want them interacting with. So this notion of an abstract data type presenting a standardized interface to your data structure for the user to use. And so they can work with your structure through that abstract interface, and then the details at a lower level, those are hidden. So that's information hiding. All right, let's see. So general syntax, right? You should be pretty well versed at this now. If statements, fors, whiles, variable declarations, all that good sort of stuff. And, you know, declaring a class, so keyword class, name of the class, curly bracket, all that stuff. Public static void main, being able to write that, and so on. I could ask you conceptual questions about statics, but you know, it's a pretty minor thing, so you definitely want to know that you use static when you say public static void main. The main thing to know about static is you know, like when we were looking at Java, we had this thing we could do, log.i, you know, to print out a log message, right? Well, what is this thing, log.i? Well, I is a method, and it's a method in this case in this class called log. But we don't have an object of type log. If we said, you know, log temp, and then we could say temp.i, right, that would be our usual way of running a method inside a class, is make an object that's an instance of that class and then use that object to get to the method. But that's a goofy thing to do. I don't want a log object. I just want to run this method. So we define this method to be static. And static means it's a class method, which means it's a method we can run by using the name of the class instead of the name of an object of that class, of type that class. So it's a convenience to let us do things like this, or, you know, the examples I always give, like math.py. And pi is a static field in this class math. All right. Method signatures, are they different if arguments have different names? No. So the names don't matter for a signature. What matters are the types of objects for each argument and the name of the method. And so implicitly, you know, the number of arguments also. So if it's got the same method name and if it has the same types of arguments in its argument list, then it's the same method. Otherwise, it's different. Cool. All right, class and method syntax, defining, creating a class, creating an instance of a class, accessing variables and methods. Yeah, okay, so that's all the stuff we just talked about. And just remember, you know, if you have an object of some type of class, you know, let's call it temp, you say temp dot to get to a piece of that object. If you say blah, that's a field. If you say blah with parentheses, that's a method. And it's the parentheses that tell you that this is a method instead of just a variable, right? If it doesn't take any arguments, you still need the parentheses so that the compiler knows this is a method, not a variable. But if you have arguments, you go ahead and you put your arguments in there. And then it goes ahead and it runs this method, right, as part of that object. All right, data structures. So that's been a big part of this course, right? So so what have we played with? Well, we played with linked lists, which, you know, are also encompassing stacks and queues and array type things. So the linked list that we get when we say linked list as a class name, gives us a more general structure than just a linked list, because we can say things like, you know, give me the fifth element, or you know, add something to the beginning or add something to the end and so on. So we can use these linked lists because you know, they encapsulate more capability than just the pure linked list we did in 2.22. So linked lists, we did trees, we made trees ourselves, we did decision trees and so on and so forth. Hash maps, right? So strings, scanners, print writers, all of these different classes. Generics, so things like linked lists and hash maps, right? They work on general types of objects, and so when we want a linked list of strings, we declare our linked list with linked list angle bracket string, and when we construct, we say new linked list angle bracket string paren paren, and so you can use that notion for, you know, linked lists of different types of objects, rectangles and integers and floats and so on. So that's the idea of a generic. Iterators, we've used these in going back to 2.24, actually, when we were hashing things for our word index, and in 2.22. So an iterator is this general notion of, if you have a data structure and you want to pull things out of there, access them one at a time, how do we do that? Well, if it's an array, we just go from 0 to, you know, n minus 1. If it's a linked list, we start at the first node and move forward. But if it's something like a hash map, right, there's no canonical first element, second element, third element, and so on. So we create an iterator which tells us, you know, here's one key, here's the next key, here's the next key, and so on. And iterators are very similar in spirit to how we use, say, a scanner, right? We make a loop which says, while there's a next line, get me the next line, or while there's a next character, get me the next character, and so on. So iterators work the same way. While there's another thing that we're able to iterate on, go ahead and give me the next value of that. All right, and strings, make sure you know how to use strings. We've been using strings all quarter, but you know, some things to keep in mind. So there's a method called length. It's a method, meaning it's got parentheses at the end that gives you the number of characters in the string. It's different from when we have an array and we just say array name dot length without parentheses. That's a field. That's a number that's stored in the structure in the class that gives us the number of elements in our array. But length is a bona fide method, right? It's a chunk of code that runs and tells you how many characters are in your string. Equals is what we want to use to know if one string is equal to another. Don't use equal equal. Okay, I'm still seeing people in office hours trying to figure out what went wrong on PA5, and a lot of times it's coming back to this. So don't use equal for strings. You can use it for characters, integers, but for objects like strings, use dot equals, and then pass the string you're comparing to as an argument. Compare to character at to string, all of that stuff, right? To string, make sure you understand that concept, which is basically when you have an object and you try to concatenate it to a string or change it into a string, the toString method is called. And there's a default toString that's inherited from object, but if you write your own, and it's got to be a public string, toString with no arguments, then this method gets called, and whatever it returns, that's the string version of the object. And so we use that to, print reasonable descriptions of rectangles and triangles and such. All right, arrays. So, you can declare arrays with brackets if you're declaring arrays of something other than primitives. You need to not only declare the array itself, but you're going to need to construct each of the objects in the array, otherwise they're null. So you get this weird two-step construction where you use the new keyword once to define the array and then again to actually construct the objects in the array. So that's the difference between an array of primitives and an array of objects. And again, there's a length field that tells you how many elements are in the array. Scanners for doing input from system.in, it's just construct a scanner with an argument of system.in. System.out.println is available for printing to standard out, so we can read from standard in right to standard out pretty easily. But we can also do I/O on files, and so we can construct a scanner or a print writer off of a new file. And so we can say new file parentheses, put in a path name, and then use that file as an argument to these constructors. And now we have a way to read from or write to a file. And when we got to sockets, right, it was the same thing. We could construct our scanner or print writer with an input or output stream from a socket, and then we could do I/O on that. So these are general classes that are useful. And print writers, mostly we just use dot print or dot print line, and also dot flush to force our output to get sent, as opposed to being buffered up. And for scanners, we usually use typically a while loop. Well, scanner dot has next line, has next byte, whatever, to tell us if there's another character available. And then when we call next line, next character, next, it gives us that input that's available. And this also gets us into try-catch blocks. So I don't think I have those listed explicitly here, but when you try to construct a scanner off of a new file, you got to put in a try-catch block. And try-catch, main thing to keep in mind, keep them tight. Make them as small as possible. Right? Don't just put your whole method in a giant try block, and don't just say throws exception on the method unless that's really what you want to do. We do say try-catch blocks down here. All right, class extensions. So when we started playing with Swing, we started trying to make classes that did a lot of stuff we didn't want to write ourselves. So we want to make a GUI pop up with some buttons on it and stuff, but we don't want to do all the legwork for, making a window that's resizable and closable and all that. So we extend the JFrame class, which does all of that stuff for us, into a new class of our own naming, and then we go ahead and we make changes or additions to that new class to customize it. And so this is a general object-oriented concept, this idea of extending a class. So we did this a lot for Swing. We extended JFrames and JPanels primarily, but it's a general concept. So when you're in a class extension, you can use super to get to stuff inside the base class, the class you extended. And this might happen in your constructor, or you know, in some method that used to do something useful, like paint, for example, does a lot of stuff. It clears the background, it redraws the borders, and so on and so forth. So if we're writing our own version of paint, we start off by calling super.paint, which says, you know, do everything that the original paint method did, and now do this other stuff. So that's the main place the super keyword pops in. Super paint, that goes on a t-shirt. Exceptions and exception handling, so that's the try catch otherwise blocks. So, you know, try curly bracket, body of code that might throw an exception, catch parentheses, description of an argument, right? A type of exception you want to catch, curly bracket, list of code that should respond, should run when you get that exception. You can have multiple catch blocks with different types of exceptions. The first one that matches gets fired. And then if you have an always block, that block always gets executed before exiting the try or catch block. All right, so swing and good stuff like that. Assuming you've been using Window Builder to create GUIs and such, right? I'm not expecting you to know how to do GUIs barehanded, right? I'm not expecting you to know how to construct a J frame and how to set up its parameters and control how it exits and so on and so forth. Because we get that done for us by Window Builder. We check a box that says, you know, put this kind of bevel around it and so on. So you don't have to construct that code yourself. But you should definitely understand the concepts that were involved in getting GUIs to work. So what are the main concepts here? Definitely class extensions. So, you know, taking something like a JPanel class, extending it. And the reason we're extending JPanels is usually so we can write our own version of Paint. And when Paint gets called, right, we can say, you know, draw a bunch of dots with some lines in between them, or whatever we want to do. And this means that you know, all of our drawing happens inside this one method, paint, but we can't call paint ourselves, right? Paint gets called by, you know, something that's managing swing. We can only call repaint, which says, hey, you know, call paint when you get a chance. But if all of our graphical output occurs inside paint, we've got to think about things a little differently. For example, maybe when you press a button, you want a circle to appear on your screen. Well, we can't, you know, go inside our button code and say, draw a circle on the screen. It doesn't work that way, right? The only place we can draw a circle is inside paint. So when we press a button, our code inside that button handler has to do something so that when paint executes, it draws a circle where we want. So it's that sort of disconnection between what we want to have happen and where it actually happens. That's the trickier part of dealing with GUIs like this. And so you did this, you know, repeatedly in PA4, PA5. So I think everyone's familiar with this, but go back and refresh yourself on that if you're not. Go back and look at some of the sample code. Write some sample code for this idea of, like, you know, setting things up so that when paint calls, it does the right thing. Event handlers, listeners, and so on. So, you know, again, we right click on a widget and we say add an event handler, and a bunch of code gets generated, and we just add, you know, the stuff that we want to have happen in there. So it's that stuff that we want to have happen in there. That's what I'm going to be testing you on. So what do we do when somebody clicks a radio button? Well, maybe we set a variable, or maybe we call a method, you know, or something. And then threads was another example of using class extensions. So we extend the thread class, which means we inherit a method called start. And the start method does two things. It creates a new thread, a separate process, and then it calls the run method in that process thread. And so to create a separate thread executing, right, we make a class that extends thread. We construct it somewhere, and then we call it start method. And that will cause the execution of whatever's in the run method, but it'll happen in a separate execution context. And so since this thread that's running is, inside an object that was constructed, say from a JPanel or a JFrame or some main program, it doesn't have direct access to things in that parent that created it. So sometimes we need to share that information with the thread. So we might pass, flags or counters or things like that, or we might just pass the identity of the thing that created the thread. So this is a spot where the this keyword comes in handy. So maybe when you construct a thread, you pass it your identity, and then it can get to you. Or maybe you use a mutexer and say, save the parent identity to be equal to this value. And so that ties in with the idea of sharing data among threads, including, from a created thread and the thread that created it. The creator has access to the created thread because, you constructed it. You have an object corresponding to that thread, but you want to get back in the other direction sometimes, so pass something to the constructor to let the created thread communicate back to the creator. And so the mechanics of sharing information is pretty straightforward. You just, you have shared objects that, multiple processes can read and write. The details of that, though, can get tricky because you get into things like resource contention. And so this whole idea of synchronizing access to an object, having atomic operations, and everything that comes with that dining philosopher's problem, the examples we did where we saw, 20,000 increments that didn't result in an increment of 20,000. That all ties into this idea of, multiple threads accessing shared data in a way that conflicts. And so we can synchronize by trying to make operations atomic, and we can do that with a synchronized keyword. And we can synchronize methods, or we can synchronize chunks of code. And so part of that is also tied into this idea of deadlock and live lock. Classic example of deadlock would be, if you did your dots game and the client and the server both decided to read the other player's name before they sent their name, right? That's going to be a deadlock because neither process is going to be able to move on to the point where it sends its name until it gets the other player's name, and they're both waiting for that information from the other. That's an easy one to rectify. Just send your name before you read the other player's name, but sometimes it's more subtle. And then the last thing we did was all of the networking stuff. So client server model, right? Server starts up, usually is listening on a port for connections, and then clients basically create a socket that tries to connect to that port. On the server side in Java, you do an accept, which returns a socket. Now you've got two sockets connected to each other. You can read from and write to those using scanners and print writers created on the input streams, output streams. And now, if I write into this print writer, a scanner reading this socket over here will read whatever I wrote, and vice versa. And all of that stuff ends up going inside try-catch blocks. Anything that might throw an exception trying to connect to a port that doesn't exist, or read from a socket that might be closed, and so on, all that stuff potentially throws exceptions. And general, well, we already said general client server model. So server exists all the time and is listening for connections. Client tries to connect to the port that the server's listening to. And typically, a server can accept connections from multiple clients and start, another thread that will communicate with each client. So you could have several transactions going at once while the server continues to listen for more connections coming in. All right, well, that was the 30-minute rehash of 10 weeks of object-oriented advanced data structures. But yeah, that's pretty much it. So there'll be more emphasis on the second half of the course. So you'll definitely see, questions on client-server, questions on sockets, questions on threading, questions on GUIs. And then, some smattering of stuff from the earlier parts of the course. So preparation, I would say, definitely go back through your previous assignments and make sure you're really comfortable with how you got these to work. And if something was kind of fuzzy, go back and think about it some more. And see if you can, maybe put together another version of your code from your head, right? Definitely think about PA5 and PA4. We talked in the beginning of PA4 about sometimes you get to a certain point and you want to go back and start over again, right? So I think some people did that with PA5. If you didn't, right, that can be a really good exercise at this point. Go back and start from scratch and try to redo PA4. It might sound like a ridiculous amount of work, but you've already done this a few times and you've worked with it for a number of weeks. You might be able to start from scratch and make a pretty good stab at PA4 in like an hour or two. And that's a really good review, and it's a really good way to sort of pin down the parts that you're still fuzzy about. Right, if you can go in, you can make a J frame, you can make a J panel, and you start drawing a paint method, and then you get to the button, and it's like, oh, wait a minute, how am I going to draw this line when the person clicks the mouse here, right? Then that's a point to focus on and think about and talk to people about and get some more clarity on. But, the programming assignments are a pretty good example. The sample code we've gone through in class is a pretty good example. Canvas should have a link. Code samples from lecture. So you got to kind of like go by the date or maybe the name. But, the stuff we've been doing, I've been trying to put up here. So if you're not sure about try-catch finally, there's some sample code, including the weirdness that returns don't happen right away until you finish the finally block. Let's see, what else can you do? There's always, tons of resources online with sample problems to work on, and it may be a little late to start trying to do that for the final exam, but if you're feeling like you've done all the preparation you can do, you understand your programming assignments and what we've talked about really well, yeah, go ahead and start looking at some of these online sources that have just sample Java problems and start working on those. So this is all really good preparation, but definitely, depending on how your summers look, don't stop coding, right? Go ahead and find some practice sites, C and Java, either way or both, right? But keep writing code. You're definitely going to hit the ground running in fall if you're going to WSU. It starts off with some pretty intense courses. And, WSU starts in August, so it's not that far away, right? I mean, it starts before summer term even ends at Clark. You're running at a pretty high RPM right now with 223. Take advantage of that. You can take a long weekend or something and decompress a little, but but try to get ramped back up as quickly as possible and really get yourself to where you feel pretty confident with at least, the core programming concepts. So that when you start classes in fall, if you're on to university, you don't have to spend a few weeks sort of getting back into the groove. Try to be there. Project Euler is a really great site. Someone just posted that in chat. That's a really good a good place to find programming challenges. Some of those are pretty intense. There's other sites that sort of start, with very basic introductory problems and build up, and you can sort of find your balance point in there. We can still turn in our SLP presentation, question mark. For the extra credit, yeah, you can do that until I would say until the end of today. Drop that into the shared folder in the announcement. And yeah, I think if you do it by Monday, actually. So Monday I'll start grading, and once I grade the final exam, I'll finalize grades in Canvas. But yeah, you can take the weekend to do that if you want. 'Cause last time I looked, there were only like two videos uploaded, and I'd rather have as many as people want to do. And it's 20 points out of 100, so that's good bonus points. All right. Well, I'm fine with doing something I never do, which is let you out of class 3 minutes early. So thanks again, everybody. It's been a good year, from my perspective at least. I've enjoyed working with all of you. I think you've all done a fantastic job. I've seen so much growth and a ton of hard work, and it's been pretty rewarding for me to see where people go on their path. And I've definitely enjoyed it. So thank you for all of your hard work and patience, and for dealing with the online situation and so on and so forth. Don't stress over the exam. Do some preparation, get some rest, come in and just show me what you know, and it'll be good. And then go on from there. All right, that's all I got. I will say thanks and take care, and have a good weekend, and I will see you on Monday.
Thanks, Nick.
You're very welcome.